I am really bad at dressing for the weather. And I blame Celsius. In this video, we finally settle the Fahrenheit-Celsius debate.
It's not even that polarizing.
Make a portable weather station and solve my problem for good. Thank you to 3M for sponsoring this video. While role models inspire young people by showing they belong in the science community regardless of gender, ethnicity, or ability, champions take it a step further by directly offering support and guidance. 3M knows that the world needs more champions to create equitable access to STEM education, so they wrote a short guide on how to become one. I linked it in the description. It's totally free and easy to read. Check it out. So the other day, the Celsius-Fahrenheit debate reemerged on my Twitter timeline, and it hit all the usual beats. But as somebody who's been firmly Team Celsius all these years, yes, I'm Canadian, I sometimes wonder, is Fahrenheit actually better? I think the problem is that I am really bad at guessing the weather. This is the hottest day, I am so sweaty, and I am absolutely convinced that it is 40 degrees. It's 26. There's like this fundamental disconnect in my brain between this number and this feeling, which means that when I get dressed in the morning, I often pick the wrong clothes. Obviously, if it's like extreme temperatures, I can usually figure it out, but it's those in-between temperatures, like 12 degrees Celsius. What does that mean? So my hypothesis is that Celsius does a bad job at communicating temperature intuitively. Now, the Fahrenheit squad claims to have solved this problem, and I think it has something to do with brine. Is this good? Now, this might be a galaxy brain move, but I think to figure this out, I need to learn how temperature was invented. Back in 300 BCE, people believed that hot and cold were two distinct metrics. Temperature as we know it didn't exist. If something felt warm, it was warm. If it felt cold, it was cold. But we know that sensations can be inconsistent, like how after a cold winter, 10 degrees may feel warm, but in the middle of summer, you might need a sweater. Or like how two people in a room can feel totally different depending on their build, metabolism, or even menstrual cycle. It was only in the early 1600s when scientists really began to use math and machines to separate sensation from science. So the quest to capture temperature as we know it had finally begun. Early thermometers were poorly designed and inconsistently calibrated, leading to two big problems. You couldn't rely on the same thermometer to give you the same reading for the same temperature, and it was difficult to compare with others who were using different thermometers. Daniel Gabriel Fahrenheit tackled consistency by using mercury, leading to more stable results compared to other options. However, he used a scale with calibration points that were difficult to recreate, leaving comparability unsolved. Luckily, around the same time, other scientists were emphasizing reproducible calibration points, including Anders Celsius, who suggested the phase transitions of water, which only made sense because of the discovery that water purity impacted freezing points. And maybe it was the convenience this discovery brought, or some other reason, but the French chose to adopt Celsius into their metric system, which carried it across the globe, except for these places. So what's the best temperature scale? Unsurprisingly, it depends. Fahrenheit is probably the most intuitive when it comes to the weather, because most of us are already familiar with a 0 to 100 scale. So if you pretend that 0 degrees Fahrenheit is like one of the coldest days you've experienced, and 100 degrees Fahrenheit is one of the hottest days you've experienced, you get this logical bridge between a number and how you might actually feel. Celsius is probably the best for communication because almost everyone uses it. If you're traveling and talking about the weather, chances are you'll be better understood if you say 18 degrees Celsius over 65 degrees Fahrenheit. So if we're looking for the best measure to tell us how we'll feel, should we use Fahrenheit or Celsius? Trick question! None of the above! Because temperature as a concept was created explicitly to remove sensation from the equation. Which is probably why your weather app might look like this, or this, or this. They may vary in levels of detail, but they all carry key metrics beyond just temperature that can impact how you feel outdoors. The most important ones I've found are temperature, wind, precipitation, humidity, and solar intensity. Temperature offers a magnitude that we can treat as a starting point. Wind and precipitation can make us feel colder than the temperature suggests by carrying away the heat generated by our body. But humidity can make us feel warmer by making it more difficult to evaporate our sweat. Finally, the sun is hot, so being in the sun makes us feel hot. Do you like this educational content? Anyway, I get all of that in concept. The problem is that I still don't know how to use it. At a dead end, I decided it was time to talk to other people to see how they solve this problem. but I quickly realized it wasn't a problem anyone else had.
You just look at the big number. You see this big number?
If it's sunny and cold, I'm still happy-ish. But if it's warm and wet, then that's like a totally different...
You just look at that number.
Will I die from hypothermia? No. Will I die from heat stroke? No. We're fine.
I don't even think people who live here in the U.S. who grew up with Fahrenheit particularly like Fahrenheit. It's just what we all learned.
As soon as it got up to 100 and I experienced it, it's like, oh yeah, okay, 100's really hot.
We relate it to past experiences when it's been 10 degrees. We know what that feels like.
Part of the problem is that you don't have a commute. Because when you're commuting in the morning, checking the weather is part of your routine and you have to kind of dress accordingly to walk to the train station.
So the problem isn't Celsius. It's me. And the fact that I don't have enough experience going outside.
So dumb.
So here's the plan. Go outside, record the weather, track how comfortable I feel, and use that data to figure out whether I should wear pants or shorts. You know, the stuff everyone else learned when they were 12. But first, I need to build a weather station.
That's what people ask me, you know, ask me what the weather is gonna be and then look at the sky and like I'm gonna get some kind of epiphany of what the weather is gonna be.
This is Dr. Samantha Ballard. She's a meteorologist, an ocean physicist, a data scientist, and I'm hoping that she can tell me how the pros turn weather into numbers.
We really need as much data as possible, so they're using everything. I like to break them up into temporal measurements and spatial, because temporal is like a point, like a buoy or a weather station. You're collecting data at one place over time. And with our satellites, we can collect over time, but it's over a series of distance, so, you know, spatially.
So these observations are used to inform weather models, which are basically formulas based on physics related to things we care about over time. By combining observations with model output, we can do things like approximate weather conditions in locations without a measurement device and forecast weather conditions into the future. But it still has its limits.
The model will output one measurement for that entire grid space, you know, hundreds of kilometers squared or at best, you know, tens of kilometers. We don't have the computer power right now to output this higher resolution.
But if the goal is to calibrate myself to the weather, I should probably know the weather exactly where I am. So my idea is to build a weather station to bring around with me. I just don't know how to do that. You see, circuits and wires have always freaked me out. Like, I don't know how this Raspberry Pi that I finessed with Twitter is a computer. Everything on it is so little and it seems fake. This can apparently sense temperature, humidity, and barometric pressure, but I could eat this. It looks crunchy. This is an IR sensor. Not fully confident what IR is. I know it's infrared, but like, what is that? And this is a light meter. I don't know how we measure light. This just seems like stuff that isn't for me, which might sound kind of surprising since I was a young Filipino woman growing up in the mid-2000s, so I was basically force-fed women in STEM role models. It was posters and videos and hashtags. I think the idea was that if I saw a poster of an engineer that looked like me, I'd know that I could also be an engineer. But I always found that idea kind of silly because I wasn't the person speaking at some sort of empowering seminar. I wasn't the person on the poster. It felt like they had it all figured out, where I didn't even know where to start. So I just didn't. Wait, why isn't this turning on? I need a battery. So I'm just gonna plug it in and see what happens. Ready? It's turning on. This is a computer, hold up. So like last year, 3M emailed us and was like, we wanna pay you guys to talk about this, the difference between role models and champions. I read the article and asked them to clarify some things because the whole thing made me revisit this existential crisis that I thought I resolved a while ago. It's why I didn't ever seriously pursue a career in science, technology, or engineering, despite being the kind of person that's clearly interested in it. Look at the videos I've made. Lots of STEM. I guess I always just thought that it was a me problem. Kind of like why I need to calibrate myself to the weather. I figured that I was just too stupid or too scared to figure it out. But this article made me consider being kinder to my past self. Maybe the reason I didn't do all of that stuff was because I didn't have a champion. You see, while a role model shows you where you can go, a champion actively helps you get there. It sounds small, but the difference in effort and therefore impact is massive. It goes beyond telling people to believe in themselves. Instead, it's informing them of what they should do and expect and where to find support. For somebody like me, whose parents were immigrants and didn't go to school in Canada, 15 years ago, something or somebody being a champion for me, that would have been life-changing. Okay, I'm gonna plug this back in and see if it senses stuff. Power. That's telling me the temperature. Anyway, it is still possible to get to where you want to go without a champion. I ended up here with you making stuff, terrible music generating machines, cat-loving AI, and sketchy little weather stations. All in our little corner of the internet where it feels kind of safe to mess up and learn together. For example, I can't wait for one of you in the comments to tell me that the idea of calibrating myself using a local weather station is moot, since the margin of error on this $3 thermometer and the margin of error on this $12 sensor that I got off the internet is probably going to make the reading so inaccurate that using my phone would have just been better. I can't relate. Okay, so now we have the right temperature, relative humidity, and a light meter. And speaking of seeing the light, after 2 years, Answering Progress is finally in a position to be a champion for others. So here are three ways that we are going to try and become champions. We're going to be using the advice that 3M listed in their article, so if you find yourself in a similar position to us, maybe check out that article and see if you can become a champion. But here's a summary. Step one, share your platform. If you're in a decision-making position or have a platform, make space for folks who haven't always been heard and listen to them. So, in our upcoming newsletters, we are going to be promoting other creators. People we just think are criminally underrated. You can recommend people you think we should check out in the form down below. Yes, you can include yourself. Okay, so when the wind makes this spin, it rotates this disc, which is made out of a paint chip. It's mostly black, but it has this little white stripe on it. See, when it spins, it's going to do that over this IR sensor. Basically, this thing is able to tell whether something above it is white or black. So we can count the number of times this thing spins and then back out the wind speed from there. It's gonna take a little bit of math. I'm just gonna copy the formula from the internet. This kind of leads me to step two, ignite and share the spark. Using your experience and passion, you can show people what the journey can actually look like and guide them as they start their own. This is an easy one. We're just gonna keep making videos showing you where our questions come from and how we get through them. Finally, step three, invest in discovering the next STEM champions. Use your resources to support programs and people. Answer and Progress wouldn't exist. I wouldn't still be making videos if we weren't lucky enough to receive the Super Patron Grant and the Vlogbrothers Scholarship to keep making stuff. And we're now in the position to pay it forward. Thanks in part to sponsors like 3M. So Answer in Progress is going to be giving away $1,000 each to these three amazing creators. They're just real cool and you should check them out after you finish watching this video, because I finished my weather station. I did put electronics for something designed to measure the weather in a cardboard box. I will not be taking further questions. It's probably not gonna rain anyway. I don't know what is sweat and what is rain anymore. So, at risk of putting myself on blast, I went outside more times this week than I have ever. I went on errands, did exercise, regretted the exercise. The whole time, I had my little weather station with me. Through sun, shade, rain, wind. I tested different outfits in those different conditions to see how they impacted my experience. And now I should have a bunch of timestamp data on weather conditions to compare against my experiences. I just need to... Now... Huh. I may have messed up. So the way this whole thing worked, right? When I plugged this thing in, it turned on. Then it would run this program that recorded the weather conditions and then saved it to a spreadsheet. After that, last line in the program, turn the machine off. I don't need it running all of the time. I'll just have it shut off when I don't need it to be on. I thought I was a genius. Wrong. Because now I find myself in the circumstance where I want the data inside of here and I need to turn it on and then copy the file from inside of it, but it turns itself off automatically. Do you understand why I'm stupid? My keyboard isn't working. I can't do the thing that fixes the thing.
I'm genuinely worried I might need to restart. Could you look at the video runtime? Does it look like it's almost over? Please tell me I figured it out. Just need to use a different keyboard. Sorry for being so dramatic.
So I was considering writing a program that would text me a recommendation based off the daily forecast. However, I can't keep going off the deep end like that. I don't think that I could be the person who gets a text every morning telling them, hey, wear shorts today. At that point, I feel like a caricature of myself. So instead, we're gonna make an infographic. I'm thinking like a flow chart or maybe like a graph.
So I'm drawing out the icons for the outfit recommendations. And now that I look at the outfit recommendations, it's funny because all of my choices are basically based off of my absolute hatred of feeling my clothes when I'm sweaty. Now, before anyone in the comments says, oh, you should just wear layers, here's my thing. I hate carrying things. So if I'm layering and then I don't need all of the layers and I have to carry the extra layers, I would rather be cold than inconvenienced. That is no one's fault but my own, which is kind of like the overall theme of this video.
Say hello to my outdoor guide for indoor kids. It's a bunch of outfit recommendations based off of temperature, relative humidity, wind, precipitation, activity level, and sunlight. So basically in the morning when I need to figure out what to wear, I just need to look at the weather, find the fit, and recreate it. Hard to believe this video was about Fahrenheit versus Celsius, but either way, have a lovely day. Thanks again to 3M for sponsoring this video. Learn how you can become a STEM champion for the people around you using the guide linked in the description. And check out our grant recipients while you're down there.